And I'm changing my mind for the fifth or sixth time, in a sense, about what to say, because clearly we have the audience is filled with friends of Gerrit. And many of you know a lot about him, but assuming that not all of you know everything, I'll read the introduction and with some modifications. So, welcome to a glimpse of the wild, large, spiritual work and life of Gerrit. I closed my eyes last night and tried to get a picture of Gerrit, and what came to mind was a wagon wheel. You know, the hub at the center, the spokes that ray out in myriad directions, and the rim for self-containment and integration. That's the image I got. Maybe in part because Gerrit grew up on a farm, I don't know. And maybe he'll say a few words about that, and maybe he won't. His family were early settlers around Albany. A village near Lansingburg was named after them. A town where, I might add, Melville lived, studied briefly, and courted a girl. Gerrit himself grew up in the township of Bainbridge, Ohio, on a farm where he was in charge of the chickens. He came across Jung at Harvard and later in New York met the secretary of the Bollingen Foundation, which published Jung. In the summer following that meeting, he took a train from Rome to southern Switzerland, where he attended the Arenos meetings, Arenos meaning love feast, on symbolical, archetypal, and mythological themes, and continued to go to the Bollingen in New York while he was working at Columbia in the publications department, and maybe he'll say a few words about that. He's delved into alchemy. As some of you know, his poetry is a kind of alchemy, and Marseille Alliade asked him to translate his great work, The Forge and the Crucible, into English. He edited Set, a journal of modernist poetics and metaphysics. His books include Heavenly Tree, Northern Earth, and A February Sheaf, and he collaborated with Nora Ligurano and Marshall Reese on the art book Turning Leaves of Mind, which he said virtually nothing about to me, and I don't know if he'll say something about that tonight. He plays on the piano Scriabin, whom he has loved since he was 10, also Fauré, Mozart, and Bach, and I'm interested in hearing why Scriabin is such a favorite. I had some idea. He collects mushrooms, sometimes in the infamous Dogtown, the abandoned island settlement of Gloucester and Rockport, where he has been known to give tours, and he's an herbalist. His partner, Derek Burton, was a yacht captain, and now and then Gerrit acted as a hand on various yachts, docking in Fort Lauderdale for extended periods. They lived for a while in Annapolis, moving in 1982 to Gloucester, where Gerrit had lived in the 60s. He was a friend to Charles Olson, who had dinner with him regularly when Gerrit lived at Hammond Castle and when Gerrit had his own home. And I think Gerrit told me once that Olson didn't cook, so Gerrit did the cooking. John Ashbery, Robert Kelly, Allen Ginsberg, Ken Irby, Robert Creeley, Diane DePrima, John Wieners, and other essential poets of our time visited him regularly and were close to him. And he is more often quoted in their books than his deep modesty allows him to mention. His calm pervades the room, and his encyclopedic knowledge makes us seek out the next stimulating books. He was a partner in both Circle West Books in Annapolis, Maryland, and Abraxas Books for 10 years in Gloucester, both antiquarian bookshops. Emerson was one influence on Gerrit, but it's impossible, as you know, to list all the influences. So wide-ranging are his knowledge and the depth of his understanding. He knows the history and practice of Tarot, Eastern and especially Western magic, Gnosticism and Hermeticism, Taoism, Vedanta and Zen, and Wicca, sometimes speaking at esoteric gatherings in Salem on subjects unknown to and hidden from most of us poets. Certainly, he's a poet of the imagination and of non-dualism and eroticism. Add to that deep reading and depth psychology, phenomenology, especially of the Merleau-Ponty type, Natha, a tantric form of yoga, linguistics and social theory, ecstasy and ecstasy, the imaginism of Douglas Fawcett, author of The World as Imagination, Carl Rook and his study of ecstatic ritual, Wallace Stevens, Coleridge, and Yeats, whom he loved but whom he realized it would be deadly to imitate. He lived a wild yet disciplined artistic life in New York with frequent trips to California, Vermont, and New Orleans. As he says, New York was initiation into street and nightclub life, mind movers and Jungian analysis. Yet he managed to receive a master's in English from Columbia, completing a thesis on dogma and natural symbol in a 17th century vision, a study of Henry Vaughan's regeneration. His life and his poetry are inseparable. He is rarely rushed or upset. He tells me that's not true, but I don't believe him. Whether having heart surgery, giving one of his informal parties, editing someone else's work, going to flea markets for books, heading to his favorite occult bookstore in Maine, or entertaining the stream of visitors who stay in his home or guest house out back, or walking on a Saturday morning with Jim Dunn and his dog. I like to delve into the sympathy of all things, he says. It seems to me that love feelings can best be expressed in poems. Gerrit will read for half an hour, and then Jim Dunn and I and other dear friends of his will deluge him with questions for an hour or so. Here is the man of the hour and the bard of the erudite and the magical.
Well, it's hard to know what to say after that. Thank you very much. Yeah. And thank you, Christina, and I'm very grateful to be here at Harvard. It's in this room, which I've used for many years now and then, since I was here in the 1940s, actually, when this room hardly existed. It now exists so beautifully, thanks to Christina, I think, and the people that she's arranged to come. Well, I'm going to, this will be a different sort of reading than my usual readings, because my books are never arranged chronologically in terms of the times in which I wrote the poems or anything. So I will try to be, since this is supposed to be a oral history of some sort, and I'm vague about what that is, really, but I'll find out. So I'm going to read poems somewhat chronologically, beginning with one poem that has to do with Cleveland, which is not particularly a clear poem, but it has to do with Cleveland matters. Cleveland was the closest town to where I lived in Ohio when I grew up, went to high school, but it was about 30 miles away, but I could drive into there with my father's car when I was old enough. Actually, I grew up driving a tractor before a car, and this was during World War II, so I was allowed to drive at 16 easily. I had a license. But this is a particular thing about Cleveland city life, sort of. And it's called From Under the Mat, Where Sat the Cat. Extricate, but not too much, unfaithful digger of concordances. Let be the whole tasty clutch of it, rhyme of I'm not awake, child, bequeathing willow trees beside a stream. Not only old ravines, but Euclid Avenue, my first escalator, Hallie's department store, were woven in the mat where sat the cat. I say department was a sexual store because mother's store it was, her bailiwick. Father absent in a void called work. Precarious. Don't try, get it all in. Bailey's was another tasty store, such glitter glass. And later learned the testicles was store, Alaya Vignana. Oh, dark, dirty Cleveland, the Viking Club, the mysteries. All I want is loving you and blank, 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 blank. That's a song of the time. It's only unmentionable because there's no end to chasing it, the tale of it and you and sustenance. Hundreds are fleeing, but not hurricanes. Violets, I always brought her wild violets in spring. Breathless romanzas secret in the flats. Percolate the spider webs. Not what you expected, eh? I could bite you back, you furry thing, but you'd never understand. So, then I'm going to read parts of other longer stories, poems that have to do with place. Or with, still before I go to away to college. So, let's see. This is a section of a poem which was dedicated to my mother, who was very important for me in terms of poetry, because my father was interested in history and physics and other things, farming, of course, and many other things, but not in fiction or poetry. So this was part of a meditation on the poet Stephen Phillips, who was a very popular poet when my mother was growing up in the 1890s and 1900s, a British poet, very romantic, now forgotten. And it was a poem of Phillips called about Marpessa, and the god Marpessa, Apollo. Marpessa chose a man before the god, chose odors of the open field and merely human intercourse. That summer, Gates Mills afternoon, when I heard the unfamiliar name I blindly was chosen for, the labyrinthine feeling way, missing forever the plausible single track that leads to sanctity or successful office building home. My veins were green when Marpessa turned me on the word, the sting, the wonder, not to be forgone. A training in and of warmth of summer nights, foxfire, under occult constellation lioness. The labor is to wrestle with the lioness, descend to man with lion power firmly in the left hand held, that neither gods nor offerings pertain. Well, I was going to read something from a class thing I wrote for the class book for 25 years, but a little bit of this was covered by Ruth. So this is prose. But this goes on, it begins about me after leaving Harvard, and we'll cut into New York, where I lived for 12 years or so. And this was written for the class book. After leaving Harvard, I lived for 10 years with frequent trips to California, New Orleans, Vermont, etc., in New York City, working at varied jobs and in publishing for George Stewart, publisher, and in the publications department of Columbia University Press. Well, this just repeats what Ruth said, yeah. Actually, you used this very well, yeah. During 1959 to 60, I moved from New York to Gloucester, Massachusetts, living first at Abadia Mare, now called the Hammond Museum, then, which was a private house at that time, then in various apartments and houses there. In Gloucester, I met the poet Charles Olson and his family. With Charles, my eyes opened again to a landscape of language and value. In Gloucester, I edited two issues of Set, a poetry magazine, using history and magic as its axes. Since 1972, I've not had a fixed living place, moving from Gloucester to Annapolis, Maryland, and to Fort Lauderdale, Florida, my current residence. Well, I think you've covered that, and this goes on. This doesn't say much more. I'll go to New York. So, in New York, I met Ailey Yarden, who's here, very important for me and for my development. I learned a lot about sociology, economic theory, all sorts of stuff going on, and how to live. And John Latouche, also, who was an extraordinary, charismatic figure in the theater world, And I was really taken up by the glamour of nightclubs and stuff that Latouche knew. He knew everybody at that time in the theater world. He'd worked with Elia Kazan, the Fink, and many other, Orson Welles. But I had a kind of double life in New York, partly through friends like Latouche and Kenward Elmsley, who I am known, and another more or less street life and bar life and sex life. This is called Judgment of the City. I take my length in tarnished lights, dirty plate glass, cold friend image. Never walked among the noble dead, who really has? Only know upper Broadway furnished rooms, naked bulbs, cigarette and cigarette, fingers calculating flesh, the noble living. And still my eyes transpose, like tiger's eyes, this world's bloody meat to everlasting bloody meat. Let's see. Don't have much time, so I'll read a little bit more. This is a poem of the same period about a friend of mine who was a magician called the Dark Grammarian. His garret overhangs the green, subtle slum where nothing culminates, and languorous, the deathly adolescents play the dooms or flex their rubber summer nights to small experiments. Bent spoons, snow, gash hounds, bright cock flame. His book of moons surrounds that life. Scholar, disdaining human love, he operates the images of universal love until the blue-black circles fill with mist and forms arise of jeopardy, crying with wakeful eyes below the floor of speech. His right hand takes the left-hand path. The sign is born and flowers in the sudden damp. Mournful angels spire down his black syntax to health. Mad and warm as children, they splash and couple in the joyous summer sea. Well, I think I'll skip some others. Well, another. Okay, thank you. Secret message. Another poem of that New York period, there are quite a few, is called simply Red Flowers in the Kitchen. No separation, a poem is not about, but I wish to praise the red chrysanthemums standing in the cut glass decanter whose top I lost that Donald Fuller gave me when he moved from 62nd to 27th Street in New York City. They're red, really red and ruddier now at evening in the artificial light against the yellow and white checkered tablecloth than in the morning when I bought them. But description is no praise. How can I invent their redness in the poem to carry calorific color to your eyes, who are beyond description too? Well, now I'll skip to some Gloucester poems because I moved out of New York. There are a lot more poems, love poems, different poems about New York. But Gloucester, I first drove through teaching this friend of mine, classmate at Harvard, how to drive. He lived in Arlington, and he had his father's car. He was learning to drive, and I had a license. So by accident, and this poem was written, of course, later, I was driving up to the North Shore and driving through Gloucester, never thinking I'd live there. So this was the way Gloucester appeared at that time. Blue, decrepit town. It takes me, here I am, living in a place I first drove through 20 years ago, teaching John to drive. Me, who was no natural American boy driver, though learned it driving tractor. Driving through, then, nervous, about these real narrow streets of this decrepit town. Nervous about all the cute, rough boys standing in front of three pool halls. Nervous about the kind of life to lead when no more college. Nervous about even what to do in bed and with whom, as the limerick goes. Now it appears that driving through this place, looking mostly straight ahead, but glancing at faces and bodies and decrepit, dirty buildings, was more than it was then, just driving through a different place, teaching John to drive. Nervous, thinking of sex, thinking of the ocean, which everywhere shone through that autumn day, because I had never seen the ocean to make it with before, being just a Heartland America boy. Now it appears that what gives us a shove, even to love, the pattern we are hung up on, or where we fell off, arises like the character of a golden lion, purely through causes, flickering lights of a decrepit town, is as empty as causes, and may be grabbed by the throat of mind much later, if at all, if you're lucky, if you've lived well, when you're no longer nervous or differently nervous, not only in seeing the whole jewel net flicker in the depths of the sea, but even as song flickers in the sight of blue, decrepit reality town, wherein dwells love. And let's see. I'll read another poem about Jack Hammond, the inventor's house where I first lived, coming to Gloucester through my friend Harry Martin in New York, who knew Jack Hammond and who had lived in New York with John Latouche. But John died in about, I don't know when, in the middle, much too young, in the middle 50s. And Harry then moved to Gloucester and became the first curator at this museum, only open part-time. And this poem is written in an older rhetoric, sort of, which I learned a lot, I thought, from Wallace Stevens, but it's kind of imitative. But it was written after Jack Hammond's death in 65 in Gloucester. And at that time, I think somebody wants to ask me about how I introduced Charles Olson to Jack Hammond, but we'll see. So the castle was named, which he built fictitiously, Abadia Mare, or the Abbey by the Sea. And a lot of it was taken from different places in Europe while Jack was putting in a radio station at the Vatican first. So this is In Memoriam, John Hays Hammond, Jr., April 13th, 1888 to February 12th, 1965. And actually this was published in the Gloucester newspaper a little bit later, which was a terrific newspaper for publishing poems by Olson and others. Anyway, it's about this. Like Tintagel, this Gothic camp, Castrum Castellum, is piled on the rocks above a northern sea. But here, in this Massachusetts fishing town, where the loom of Europe fades, on this invented house, harangued and fabled by the sea, the emptiness of great night falls, and we mount the corkscrew stair, ignoring flagrant chasubles, to greet the shabby moon that tramples the waters to golden unrest. Urban hells seem fictive here, where mind reflects the motions of the sea and of the Gothic past. Time flickers in the salty, star-pricked air, and the Gloucester buoys dip. Yet even here is noise of death and blood. Gulls' jagged screams impale the night. There, that blacker shape is Norman's Woe, a reef made infamous by poetry. Gulls nest there, rest from killing. Rats swim out at night, Jack says, to feast, red eyes advancing through the waves. a meal of feathers and of blood. Downstairs again, we talk of automatic death, the hydrogen bomb and the Aquarian age. But we turn from the follies of human speech, tie the Siamese cat is asleep, the ear is hallowed and taken by music, mingling with the ocean's recurrent faith. Here, immured in fidgets of a faithful age, faith, each one thinks apart, faith, make faith. Oh, weak, 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 good simplicity of water, rock, and brilliant moon, you are enough. And I'll read some very short poem about Gloucester. There are a lot of poems here that deal with. This is simply called Dusky. Filled with, by plasmatur, rain, gray syllables, Goose Cove Reservoir. This is another short poem written quite a bit later, actually, called Sunset as Early Warning System. Inordinately extending, vision wraps surpassing up the harbor and the gulls, this picture, and all virgins elevated to the last clenches of light. How many, I do not ask, it is the instant of convergence, the flare. And so comes in me as him the world and unfigured spin of dimensional being, beyond anecdote, well, undesignated, apt to make of Gloucester roofs a diagram. This is another poem. I lived near this Ravenswood, a large, wonderful park in Gloucester. I call it later in another poem, The Ravening Wood. This is called The Curve. How one incurs the burden of a city and Indians. This is where I came in, by the pest house, through the old woods, not over that flubbery span no sentinel owns, comes into one's own reality. Making the place by pacing the place, live or live, change vowel, I, heart. The stature commensurate to the gist of the nation, imagination. Against the curve, the way it slants in, the lay of the land, unseen but by Indians, then. Thanks ever be to Charles Olson for Indians, then. The alien eyes, mine eyes have seen thee. Mine eyes alien, Dutch, not Indian. Outer planetary were keener for the curve. How wolves and lions came in. Quote, some affirm that they have seen a lion at Cape Ann, which is not above 6 leagues from Boston. So I round another man's measure to round out my own, to speak of discoverer, the pristine we work to inherit, native load to shoot out again, is not to make up, Harry Martin, some queer hemisphera. It is to smell, to dig with the hand, to demonstrate, and at least to reclaim, to come in, like Indians, on this curve from the ravening wood to a city we once could be citizens of. And this is a little lyric about living in Gloucester. I didn't think much of it, but my friend Joe Tora praised it, so I'll read it. Called A Simple Fire of Wood. Love, too much likeness saps. Lover's difference sustains their love, the stalwart sailor and the poet. I used to dream that sailors dreamed of other sailors, but now I guess it is of poets and hearths they also dream. Two cats before the fireplace. Two cats before the fireplace. In slanting light of Raven's Wood, we decided for a rosy hearth to keep the fire virgin in, where the poet and the sailor, happy criminals in love, united in a rhythm simple as the poem, two cats before the fireplace. Now, let's see. Well, I'll do some more of these somewhat pastoral poems, I guess. Look at time. This is Strolling Pebble Beach in February. This again was written much later than its place in the book. His rock is not my rock, nor yours. Hot your palm makes it glow, that core a whirlpool in the rock. Stoned, we listen, dumb, or see one red bird in a jungle of grapevines. This is looking at a lot of paintings in the sky, but seeing one master scrawl. Underlies, it does, spread of choices, Wamba's fan-shaped destiny, rocky patternings, to find, refined perception. And one, I guess, final poem of this thing, period, called Anisquam Nights. I tell you it was real, bayberry bushes on the hill, the house, yellow moon and simple love. But oh, fox laughter from the woods, the white fox running through the pines. Let's see, I'm getting to the end of time here. I wanted to read a little bit of the magazine set, the editorials. I thought I'd read things about my attitude to poetry and how it had been changed by a lot of different people, Robert Duncan, Charles Olson. This was not in the magazine set. This was in another magazine, and it's simply about poetry and my idea of it. La plage poétique. Nations of poetry on the beach, scanning horizons endlessly, awaiting. Poetics will be planetary or not at all, homage à André Breton. Its data and resource unrestricted by any tradition. The word of sin was always restriction, and in the bondage scene of verse was always, at its best, high play, game of decorum, the keeping, the conventions apt to some local time crystal. The dead hand or confusion of times was ever to take the living rules of one historical moment and try to fasten them down on another time, pseudomorphosis. The restricted notion of form never furthers. Form-content opposition is not an idea fruitful to explore. But what may be fruitful, the direction pointed by glossomatics, definition of linguistic elements on sub-sign level by their combinatorial relations only. In aesthetic theory, this is paralleled by a fundamental contextualism and perspectivism. The graveled ways of those poets involved in practicing what they already know, for example, Auden, Jay Merrill, Larkin, are less informative of song than the bewildered hike of a Kalibnikov. Dusky Whitman says, quote, at its best, poetic lore is like what may be heard of conversation in the dusk from speakers far or hid, of which we get only a few broken murmurs. The space that opens out in a planetary poetics is not imperial, universal, making the soul as always particular in whatever tongue. Even parochial, the historic you inhabit is also the formant, manifesting the unheard etheric formative forces and the isness of the mere objectiveness of things, Stevens, includes the language in which you wreathe it, wreathing and writhing and rhythmingly, rhythmetric, all shine together in the moonlight or sunlight falling on Tellus. That figurative beach or page is ahead for launching or welcoming down the grand insolite poems to come. And that was written later, but I'll just read a little bit more prose about that was in the Burden of Set, the editorials, which were somewhat polemic for the time, which was early 60s. So I'll just read a couple. One of the first issue of Set, and this is called The Knife of Set. I explained somewhere the meaning, the lot of meanings of Set, why it was called that as a magazine. B, the weight, threat, and promise of artistic permanence or greatness is now lifted from the soul of the seer. Persistence remains an interesting question. Since culture is dead, bred cultureness, that goes on, we are all enveloped by its stink. Some poems measure the sensitivity of the nose. But energy at least and at last is free to recognize itself, the work of the 13th eon or sphere or month. Poetry falls on an age of undoing like nothing known before, and right, measure, and metric flow from the crystal of the moment. Memento and talisman are dimensional of the influx. The metric of the contemporary must be a gain of form arising from the shift of obedience. Although this shift is in part a displacement from traditional external forms of order to the shape of the person, no doctrine of personism or composition by hazard need be invoked to the creation of the poem. The basis of all metrical determination must be sought outside the manifold in the binding forces which act on it. That's a quote the great 19th century mathematician Riemann wrote. And if applied to poetry, as everything must be sooner or later, this delivers the poet to the full complexity of how he uses what comes into him. Alchemists and cooks have the same problems, how to manage the heat. A parfait master ye may call him true, who knoweth his heats high and low. Then, image is deficiency, as the Gnostics say, and any typology of poetic image gets hung up on the line of similarity comparison. Insofar as image is referential, it means a leak in the vessel, which should be hermetically sealed for the cooking, en daube. The poem had better move out. So, and then I'll read one more. Well, this is too long. Yeah, I'll read a poem that's not in my book of poems, and another thing about polemic, more or less, about the time in the early 60s in poetry. The new attentions with three glances at value. Okay, let it come down in on us, all of it, as much as we can. And then to get it out again, that was an epitome of yoga inside front cover of Set number one. Set still, stop thinking, shut up, get out. And yoga is concentration of experience, exclusion too, yes, but not of experience itself, rather of experiences not really experienced enough, restraint of the modifications of mind in order to feel their source. Whose enemy is abstraction, distraction, retraction, anything or way that hinders the going traction. It's traction we are after too, the freedom and recognition of. The enemies, listed in the Burden of Set One as disposables, all function as guardians of value. Not value as tropism that we all have, but abstract judgment, ideals. And then I'll skip a little bit. Anyway, this is a poem, Three Glances at Value. One, in an iron age, bitch, she strides from iron pinnacle to pinnacle, the pinnacles clothed in iron robes, unsmiling. Hair is iron gray, bowels tight. Night jars play about her splendid shoulders. Her left hand spills the iron jar of equity. Her right hand brandishes the iron flail of separation. Where she is, a darkness is, and adjectives. The line is rigid. Her patrols are ugly throats. She is backward to the dawn of universal breath. Two, loot, archetypal value. It began in ignorance, away from vidya, birth of value in the straw and dung of the first unstable economies. Though value never vector is standard only, there remains the process. But standard of gold was made gold standard, and when a sign of value, say dollar sign, itself is made of value, dollar sign, exclamation point, value process desiccates, stands still, turns mechanically in standard, because the normal straight relation of X, the sign, like dollar sign, to that of which it is the sign, grows ghostly, self-reflecting, craving, craving, craving endlessly. Without measure, this horror. Who takes measure of value for value is double damned, makes sickness of metaphor, confusion of tongues. Lightning breaks tower as counsel darkens. Value is brilliantly borne aloft in hot chariots, while glittering out of sky, hate falls on helpless wheat. Theory of value in itself must then imply an economic scrutiny, how an image differs from a thing, fluctuation of the dollar, waving of linguistic formulas in the wind of mind. It is the value moving, the language of value, rational measure, not rhythm, or moving measure, or mastery of time and fire. That is alchemy. Well, I'll close with a poem, which is related to this. This is, but one I like. I'm not reading a lot of poems that I particularly like, because most of you, my friends, have heard them a lot, and so I'm, anyway, let's see, where is this poem? I'll have to look it up. I thought it had it here. The compost. I was speaking, he said, of American poetry, or was it the other way round, the way under the hill? The snowy eye is absolute. The measure sustaining is never provisional. Majestic, it opens on silence. So the forefathers looked, and this is the dream of the effulgent republic, without question of affluence. Their advice to young men, will, dare, do, and shut up, period, about it, has been prized, even by those to whom the name of John Marshall is mud or an elegant rumor, for how it pertains to the art. That the rebirth of the Republic is not eagerly awaited admits of no doubt. But the fact is redoubtable, redounding in the speeches of labor leaders and other amenagogues of history ignorant. Such conditions enhance the men of the secret who care for the compost in winter, waiting to ready the fields. To attend the currency in votive weather behooves. Viridescent, the triangle floats over the altar. Offering made, it has snowed. Poverty drifts in massive installments through villages, operas, sex never imagined in the dreams of John Marshall, work undertaken without prospect of gain, unnatural work which the Republic itself turned out to be, stupid and savage as an intractable poem. Ain't pleasant to work at the compost, but the niches are empty. And the eye will terribly blaze from the triangle when the lion god at last steps forth by day. Thank you.
That was a beautiful reading. Thank you, Gerrit. Thank you very much. I'm the facilitator. So what I like to do is get out of the way, but I'd like to say a couple things. Gerrit, to me, has many, many unbelievably brilliant connections and geniuses. But one of the geniuses, besides his obviously brilliant poetry and his mastery of the form, is his genius for friendship. And so I'd like to start just making connections from, I mean, we don't have to go chronological, but I'd like to pull in a lot of really close friends are here. So I'd like to start by saying, at a very young age in Chagrin Falls, what was your poetic influence? And when did you know you were going to be a poet? And was that path clear?
Well, that was part of what I read about my mother.
Right.
That's where I read poetry and Marpessa. And Walt Whitman was an enormous influence reading in high school. And then a guy who worked in a bookshop in Cleveland that I'd go into named Glenn Freeman was an influence, but not so much in poetry, but as in general life.
Yeah.
So it wasn't until I came to college and met John McGarren, particularly, my closest friend, who was became a librarian and was a poet and had been from his high school in Arlington, that I began reading a lot of E.E. Cummings, for example. Like, yeah! And I read him in high school. And T.S. Eliot, and then discovered Wallace Stevens, who I heard read in person with John McGovern.
Here? Was it here?
At Harvard. No, it was in Emerson Hall, or one of the halls, a very small audience, like this, actually, then. And I also heard Eliot read. Anyway, those were early influences, and my friend Kenward Elmsley, who was a close friend, developing later into a poet. He was more interested in theater at first, but he remained a close friend and still is. Yeah.
Do you want to talk a little bit about how you and Kenward met and how you guys knew you were artists and how that developed? Or
well, through Kenward, who was a class behind me at Harvard, in New York, I met John Latouche, who was an extraordinary, charismatic person. Charismatic in a way that I really couldn't describe, but because he came from great poverty in Virginia and taught himself piano, music, poetry. He won a poetry prize at Columbia. He played in nightclubs. So he was very influenced by Bertolt Brecht, particularly as a writer. And so I read Brecht. And, so that was another personal influence. Yeah.
We were talking yesterday about his apartment at Park Avenue and how...
Well, that was before I met him. He was a friend of Paul and Jane Bowles, whom I met later in New York, but they were married in his apartment when he was married to his first wife. Yeah.
Yeah. And he was a composer and he was a...
He was a librettist. He wrote back in the 30s an important musical called... what was it called? With Ethel Waters in it. Can't think of its name now, but it was very famous and made him a lot of money. And then he wrote, during World War II, a very popular song for Paul Robeson, sort of a trashy but political popular poem called Ballad for Americans that also made him a lot of money, yeah, which we didn't value much.
And through him you met Harry Martin?
Through him I met a lot of different people. Harry Martin, many, many other people I knew in New York in a double way. The composer Ben Weber was very important for me, and I met him separately from Latouche. I met and knew well Christopher Isherwood, who stayed with me, and he was important. There were constant influences. I mean, I can't really separate them.
Well, step back a little. When you came to Harvard, you met, as you said, McGovern, who... He had a really cool, kind of like a butler vibe to him. He was really an amazing guy because I met him a couple. And he became a librarian down in Hartford, right?
He went to library school in Boston at Simmons. He came from Arlington, as I said, and then became the librarian and remained there always at Hartford University. Yeah. And when he retired, he moved back to Boston. Yeah.
And you met Ted Gorey while you were here, right? And,
that was in New York, yes, indeed. And Frank O'Hara, John Ashbery, I knew in college, and we saw a lot of each other in New York. At that time in New York, there were not many, until the late 50s, there were not many poetry readings in private places. Strangely, they they boomed and blossomed with the Beat Generation in the late 50s. I met Jack Kerouac through Latouche and Philip LaMantia, who was more influential to me. But, you know, I could go on and on about various people that in some way influenced me.
Gregory Corso?
I met Corso once. He was not an influence. I met him at the bar at San Remo, where everybody hung out. Harry Smith, a movie maker and important music creator, though not a musician, was an important influence in a different way. Yeah.
Well, Harry Smith was going to be in set, or you asked him to be in set? Or?
I did. Yeah. I asked him because he had written things, but he did not want to publish anything at that time and didn't until after his death. His notebooks are now being excavated.
Well, speaking of music.
Yeah.
You said that you played in a band in the late 30s and 40s. You played popular songs?
Well, that was in high school, yeah. A band that played with other classmates in my high school, played for dances. So we played things like Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree with Anyone Else But Me. There'll be Bluebirds Over the White Cliffs of Dover. These were all popular bits, during World War II. And when Frank Sinatra was beginning to come into his own, that was even a little bit later.
But you were already playing Scriabin and Bach?
I discovered Scriabin very early and felt an affinity, but I also played a lot of Mozart classical work, yeah.
What is it about Scriabin that you love so much?
Well, back then, he created a kind of trance state in me without my knowing what it was. I broke a wrist ice skating and had a deep anesthetic and realized then that was trance, that was ether that was used then, so the anesthetic. Yeah. And then later in Paris I discovered the pleasure uses of ether, sniffing.
Have you been to the Ether Dome? Have you been to the Ether Dome?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we're talking a little bit about your apartment in New York. So you went to New York on Wharton Street that you flip-flopped with?
Well, I lived in New York in the 50s. It was extremely easy to move around from apartment to apartment. They were very cheap, like $30 a month was one, Wharton Street, which later John Ashbery took from me, which I gave to him when I moved to another place. Yeah. So I moved all over in about 10 places in 10 years, or maybe even more.
It seems like you were gravitating to New York, and it seems like that's where you wanted to be. Why did you leave?
I was getting a little weary of the city, actually. And then when Harry invited me, and I knew Jack Hammond in New York also, again, another friend of Latouche's, who he had a house in New York. He was an inventor. So I was invited up to Gloucester, and there I met Olson, who I knew about through Jonathan Williams, who lived in Staten Island and was a friend of mine at that time. And then, again, my life changed. I realized I wanted to be in Gloucester. But meanwhile, I'd sublet my apartment, which at that point was about $80 a month, to a friend in New York. So I kept it there, so I'd go down to New York a lot. And then I met my life partner, Derek Burton, in Gloucester, and then decided to live with him. As one of those poems.
As you guys were traveling to Jacksonville, back, did you write a lot? Or was it inspirational living in Maryland and traveling?
Well, Maryland was later.
At
the beginning, yeah. Derek worked for people who had a boat that was kept in Fort Lauderdale in the winter and Gloucester in the summer. And the family didn't travel on the boat, so just Derek and I, he'd handle the boat. It was a diesel, and I just handled the lines going down and it stayed. I was carrying Set magazine, which I had published then, on the boat to Fort Lauderdale at one point.
Yeah. Well, so can we talk about that a little bit? So Set, the historical, the magical, I think we said the other day that there's a lot of people that submitted stuff that you did not include because you had a very specific
idea in mind. A piece in this that wasn't in Set that I could read. I think it's in here. I'd sent a little letter to Frank O'Hara, Kenward, many friends about Set. And this is, then I wrote this later in 1997 in Gloucester about how Set was conceived. Because it was In 1959, when I decided to produce a small magazine, I sent out a note, a prodrome, about the magazine's contents and format to a number of poets and poet friends. I said that set would be photo offset, appear irregularly. And by that time, I had known I was a good friend of John Wieners and knew his magazine Measure. And there's a long story about how he helped me get find a printer for set. I said in this that set would be photo offset, appear irregularly. As to intent and content, I wrote, quote, set will be about the poetic exploration of the swarming possibilities occult and or unused in American life, urban and local, here and especially now at this moment of the eon, that is the vulgar advent. Quote, the gates of memory and intuition, history and magic opened from a windowless monad into time, I wrote to Kenward Elmsley, amplifying a sentence in my prodromic statement. Thus, its set's character will be dual, historical and magical, the emphasized characters of time. And that phrase delighted Robert Duncan. Quote, then, in this time moment, poetry and science meet. Hence, the manifesto states that set is interested in material relevant to the poetic scientific study of American experience and nature. But, quote, as I wrote to Frank O'Hara, I don't want set to be polemic about America with a K. There'll be more James Dean and Andrew Jackson Davis than Marcel Marceau or the Tsar Peladon. I also wrote Frank, certainly I want neither the monumental nor the study, the nature mort or vivant of the Mrs. Moore, Bishop Wilbur, etc. And that's pretty dated, yeah. And then around that time, about the name set, I wrote Steve, the poet Steve Jonas, one of my closest friends in Boston who lived here, that the name of the proposed magazine comes on like or in the places of its play as, one, jazz, which most readers will probably read primary, set. Two, stance. Three, direction. Four, theory of sets in Mathesis. Five, tennis, for those who like it. I like playing tennis. Six, the God, by the Chenobaskian Gnostics, identified with the biblical Seth. And, Shem, Melchizedek, Christ, Antichrist, Saturn, Typhon, Mercury, Dionysius, sacred ass, Capricorn. Enough or too much, Blake says. So set actually had more definitions than any other word in the big Webster's International, I found out. So that's why I called it set.
Here's one of them, and here's the Harry Martin cover. He did both of them, right?
That's right. He did that cover. That's set number two, yeah.
And you were saying that Jonas and I think Ed Dorn had poems that were a little salty, so they
in set number one, the printer in Gloucester that Hammond recommended kept it a long time, but then he said, this isn't the kind of material I want to print. So there I was with the stuff already accepted for set, and then walking in Boston with John Wieners, I told him this problem. He had recommended Joe Dunn as a printer, but Joe's physical and psychic condition was such he couldn't possibly be a printer at that time. I met him then. He had just come back from California and was not in a good way. And so John pointed up at this as we walked by on Tremont Street, a sign, Hutchison Printer. And so I went up there, and no problem. Printed it reasonably. I got people to give me money for it because it wasn't expensive, and printed several copies, and then sold it for a buck to various poetry bookstores around the country, giving them a regular 20% discount that bookstores needed at that time.
So, how come there wasn't a third, or when's it coming out?
Well. Stan Brackage wondered about a third. He was visiting me at the time of two, but it just never happened. At one point, Derek got different jobs, and we stopped going. Then later, I moved to Annapolis for a while. Yeah.
You published Aleister Crowley, but nobody knew except one person, right?
Well, Ed Sanders realized, because I published the wonderful prose poems called In the Book of Lies, written by Frater Perdurabo, which was the name of Aleister, one of the names of Aleister Crowley. Ed Sanders did know that Frater Pedrabo was Aleister Crowley, who at that time was not much published or reprinted at all, and not known very well.
And what about Frater Ach? Is it Frater Ach?
Yeah, I didn't print him. But,
I can't imagine what your conversations with Robert Duncan must have been like. The two of you could talk about, you overlapped in so many ways, and you both could free associate and go off into other subjects. Can you say a little bit about your conversations?
Well, he was almost like too much of an influence in a sense, in many ways, when I was in New York, when I read him before I met him. I met him first in New York before I came up to Gloucester, when his play Faust Futu was being done by Diane de Prima, and a part of it, and he gave a reading. And then I told him I was going up to Gloucester, and he said, say hi to Charles. But then I met him again at Bard College when he came to give a reading with Robert Kelly, another influence on me, indeed, who published the first edition of my book, Heavenly Tree. It was called then Heavenly Tree Grows Downward. And Robert and I spent a night there at Bard talking. And then much later, I came to show him a long serial poem I'd written with his approval. That would have been when he was a second time at Bard. But we talked about a lot of things at that time. Charles, persons more than poetry.
Persons more.
Yeah, yeah.
And back to Wieners and Jonas. How did you meet Jonas and became such good friends with him? And was that around the same time that Set came out, or was that prior to that?
Well, I don't really quite remember in what order I do remember meeting Wieners briefly with Frank O'Hara, very briefly, before he went to California. That was only when I was up for the Poets Theater, but was living in New York. But then later, I met him, maybe, I don't remember quite how, or with Steve at the same time, or later, yeah. But I saw him often in New York when he went down there, and also Jonas in New York when he occasionally made trips there.
Will you say a little bit about Ken Irby, your friend who died?
Yeah, I met Ken Irby, who was published also by Robert Kelly in an early book, and was teaching at Tufts. And he came out to Gloucester, and he had met Charles and Creeley before. Well, I'd met Creeley before, too. But and then, anyway, I got to know Ken, and he visited me. We clicked completely, and so he visited me every year. And we read together in New York a couple of times, at the Ear Inn and at St. Mark's.
And I think The Wizard of Oz and Blizzard of Oz is one of the first poems I heard you read at
really?
TT's.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Ken was there. So was in that.
That's right, yeah. I think where I read that first, and maybe I've been in New York at that time. I'm not sure when.
By the way, you said that the French poets were an influence on you and some of the New York school.
Well, absolutely. In the 50s, the New Directions publication of Apollinaire was very important for Frank O'Hara, for John Ashbery, for me. John knew, this was before he went to Paris, but he knew French very well, but still, he knew Max Jacob, but that was a very important influence. The Apollinaire seemed, and of course, Rimbaud in many translations. My first roommate at Harvard gave me a paperback of Louise Varese's translation of Rimbaud, The Illumination, which incidentally Ashbery translated beautifully not so long ago.
You read a lot of philosophy at Harvard.
Yeah, I did. There were some great teachers there. And,
Elman's course on Blake and Yeats.
And Ashbery and I both took a graduate course on Blake and Yeats by Richard Elman, which was a great course. Indeed, because at that point, Yeats' scholarship was in its infancy, basically, and people thought he was a nut later on because of the vision.
And you've read them lifelong, both of them.
Yeah, correct. Yes, yeah.
So when you got to Gloucester, it was a hard time trying to find Olson because he didn't have a phone, or was it?
Well, no, we, Kenward, who was also staying at the Hammond House, our castle, and Harry Martin and I knew he lived in Gloucester somewhere. Jonathan Williams hadn't given me an exact address. And there was another Carl Olson in the phone book. We called and he said, "No, that's not. I'm not the guy. But he lives over in the fort and doesn't have a phone." So we drove there and knocked on the door about 4 p.m. and met Charles, who was just waking up, getting up, and then stayed there the rest of the day. And then Harry invited him off into the castle, and he met Jack Hammond, and they got along very well. He came a lot for dinner to the castle, and also with his wife, Betty, who was there, and his sister-in-law, Jean Radoslovich, and her kids came and swam in the castle pool. There was a big pool inside, a good, warm pool.
Didn't you guys promote a reading by Olson at the castle?
That's
by
right.
Putting flyers
the first reading that Charles had in Gloucester, Harry and I put up notices of the letters. He wanted to be thought of as an antiquarian letters, just not a poet. We put them up in Rockport. And very few people came, about 10 people to the castle to hear that first reading of Charles. Yeah.
Do you remember when that was?
It would have been maybe 1960 or something. There are records of it very early on. Yeah, maybe 61 or maybe even 59, I don't know. Yeah.
Did he read with anyone else, or was it just...
No, just by himself. But various people came, because the castle had a movie projector, and when Stan Brackage was in town, we showed some of his movies at the castle, Harry did, and he also showed movies of Maya Deren and various others there, too.
Did you ever play that huge organ that...
I did, but yeah. I was not really an organist. Yeah, I did. It's there were free. There were organ concerts in the summer, for the public to come in. But basically, it was the public didn't get into the part that was still a private house.
What were the parties like with her?
There were parties later. Yeah, yeah. To drink.
You want to talk about any of the visual artists you knew in New York? Jane Freilicher and Larry Rivers, Grace Hartigan.
Yeah, well, I knew a lot of the visual artists at the beginning. They all showed at the Tibor Denage Gallery, which was a very small gallery at that time. Also, Betty Parsons Gallery, which was a much more, was an uptown gallery. But the gallery world was in New York was very, very small at that point. Another friend of mine, Robert Fraser, who died British, but worked at Durlacher's, which was a very conservative gallery, selling Rembrandts if they had them things. But he started working until he started his own gallery in London, became a good friend of Mick Jagger's, was photographed, handcuffed to him in a famous British painting called Swinging London by Hamilton, and then unfortunately died of an OD in India. But he was a wonderful guy, another good friend.
And in New York, you were working at the Parapsychology Foundation.
Well, my interest in parapsychology began in college when I founded, with other people, the first parapsychology club there, and they let us put books on such on the shelves, but the psychology department, which was totally behaviorism in Harvard, had no use for it, but they allowed Gardner Murphy, who was a very eminent psychologist, to come and give a talk, and he was sympathetic. And also we worked with a man who in the 40s was very famous at Duke University, Dr. Rhine, one of the first university parapsychologists in the country, and who wrote actually best-selling books in the 40s, and developed the five symbol cards called Zahner cards that were used in parapsychology testing for years. So, and then in New York, because Hammond was extremely interested in parapsychology, I met his friend and the president of the Parapsychology Foundation, Eileen Garrett, a quite amazing woman. And can't say she was an influence, but she, I had enormous respect for her and was amazed at her. She was a very powerful woman. She was a medium who always, British, who always welcomed scientific testing. And Hammond had built this electronic cage called a Faraday cage, which would turn off and on magnetic fields, which hung from the major hall of the castle, was about four stories high, the great hall. And she went into a trance there and gave, and wouldn't know when the magnetic field was going on. I mean, you wouldn't feel it because it, and gave him advice about some of his inventions. And those, after his death, all of those things are now at the Franklin Institute in Philadelphia, and the scientific, where his papers are. Yeah.
Whose inventions? I'm sorry.
John Hayes Hammond Jr. Yeah.
Yeah. We have to.
Yeah, his wife was.
Yeah. I think we have other questions to ask, but I think there are several people who are here who are.
Yes,
yeah.
Any questions? Yes. Ailey, what?
How did you escape Christianity?
How did I fake it? I
couldn't escape it.
Escape it. Well, I really didn't go much to churches. My mother was an Episcopalian, my father was a kind of deist. And I was fascinated by Christianity. I went when I came to Cambridge. I went to all sorts of Quaker meetings, or Catholic churches, many theosophists. I had been influenced by Uspensky in high school, whose books were popular, and William James. Did you use the word escape? No. I wouldn't say I escaped it because I was never there. I became very interested in it and in the relation of Christian mysticism.
About its centrality, I'm referring to its centrality in literary thought.
Well, I read in Harvard the writing, the novels of Charles Williams, who was a special but a heretical Christian, liked him very much, I liked those. I read C.S. Lewis, disliked him because of the dogmatism, but liked him for one book on English scholarship. And I read Rudolf Steiner, who was a kind of Christian. So I don't feel I escaped it particularly because I wasn't there to escape it. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks, Ailey. Yeah.
Two very specific questions. One, can you talk a little bit about your meeting with Diane de Prima and the subsequent just ongoing friendship?
Well, yeah, I first met Diane in New York and didn't know her well. Met her at a party, and she was about probably 19, I think, then, maybe a little older. She'd been a dancer and was, I at that time was not. I wasn't living in the village. West, the East Village, by the way, was just coming into its own in the 50s. I mean, Greenwich Village was still affordable and was sort of the village. The East Village was starting. And at that time, Diane was living with Roy. But I didn't know her well until much later, until she came up to Gloucester several times, visited. But actually, I knew, of course, the magazine, Jugend, yeah, and knew Roy, who came up visiting to Gloucester. But so our friendship developed. Well, actually, it was in New York a little bit later, after she was no longer living with Roy, and I was coming back to New York, and she was living with Alan Marlowe. And I stayed there in the Hotel Albert where she was living. And at that time, Tom Meyer and I were traveling together and stayed with Diane. And so I did see her play, the plays that she put on. And that would have been in the late late 50s and 60s, of, you know, I guess. Yeah, I don't know if that answers enough of the question. But we also clicked in our interests. I mean, she was studying Sanskrit, and actually tantric Hinduism before Buddhism. And she's remained very knowledgeable about Tantra and told Charles Olson this was the religion of America, and she was right. And, because I've been involved in what's called a Typhonian tradition in the West, which is a secret tradition, but which is based on Tantra and goes back to 19th century German magical practices and before that.
This other question is both, I guess, very personal, but also historical. I just wonder if you could reflect a little bit on, you know, January and February 1970 were difficult with the death of Charles Olson and then Steve Jonas. And I think something happened, you know, besides them leaving the plane. And I wonder if, from your perspective, you could say something about.
Well, yes, this was when I was getting ready, really, to move to Annapolis because my friend Derek's getting a job there. And it was a time just after this crisis that I spoke about the other night with you for John Wieners, which changed his life utterly, unfortunately. And Creeley was then, after Charles' death, came to Gloucester and rented the house. And so I moved in the early 70s. I was ready to move to Annapolis, which I did and lived there. Coming back to Gloucester often, going to New York too. And in Annapolis, I was hospitalized for alcohol addiction and other addictions, but mainly alcohol. And opened with friends the first time I opened a used bookshop in Annapolis there. So. My own life was going through what Jung calls this reversal of opposites, an antiodromia, which happens to men around 49, usually, in the Jungian thing. And Jung is one of the psychologists who, like the Hindus, believe in phases of life biologically. And at that point, for men around women in slightly different years, this total change of his categories, introversion to extroversion, happened, which I saw in my own father, who had been extroverted, but when he became 50, became extremely interested in writing the history of the world in maps and became interested in mysticism. I read to him once the entire chapter of William James, Varieties of Religious Experience, on mysticism, which was an amazing work still, that whole book. Because it deals not only with the above-ground mystics that are accepted to some degree by the Roman Catholic Church and Christianity, but also the underground mystics of the time that were the beginnings of Christian Science and Theosophy. He quotes Madame Blavatsky's Voice of the Silence, one of the few books. It's still admired by Aleister Crowley later, and even reprinted by Crowley, who admired Blavatsky and didn't, in fact, thought he was related to her in some weird way. But
you can also ask questions.
No,
I wanted you to say something about abraxas, the meaning of that word and how it came into your life.
The word goes to me a long way back. My interest in Gnosticism as a movement went back, I can't remember when it began. It certainly began before the great discovery in Egypt of the Kenobaskian scriptures, because Gnosticism was known through polemics against it by the church fathers, Irenaeus and to some degree Tertullian, Clement. So there was a lot known about it, but not as much. But there was even an underground history of people following it. And Abraxas was one of the late Hellenistic deities whose name in Greek letters equals 300, which is a numerology, 365. So he's a god of the year, and he is a specifically a Gnostic god. However, in the 60s, the word became very popular because of the popularity of Hermann Hesse's novels, which were translated and were part of the whole Beat movement. All of Hesse suddenly became translated. He had written a novel, Damien, way back in 1912. It was extremely popular in Germany. And in that, the god Abraxas plays an important part. A god of shadow and goodness, a good, like the god Shiva, a god of good and evil, so-called, in Western terms. And so all over America, people were reading Steppenwolf, Damien, and later the Glass Bead Game, from which Timothy Leary took the name of his foundation, Castalia. So Hesse was a bestseller in the 60s.
Well, related to that, will you say a little bit about your interest in Hermeticism and Emerson? And you told me that Olson told you that Thoreau wasn't thorough because he didn't deal with the dark side.
Well, basically, it's kind of interesting to me that Olson was really so bound up with Melville, who did indeed, he wrote a Gnostic poem even called that, actually. Mm-hmm. And the Hermetic side of Emerson, which is absolutely there through Neoplatonism, formed Robert Duncan. Robert Duncan was an Emersonian, yeah. And the division between Gnosis and Hermeticism is very known now, between Gnosticism and Hermeticism, in terms of their relation to nature. And there are a number of scholarly books on this. They unite in one sense in the belief in a direct experience of Gnosis. But the Gnostics often, though Gnosticism is very complex, take it one way, whereas Hermeticism, like Neoplatonism, admires the things of this world in many ways. But the whole matter is extremely complex because Vedanta, itself is not, which leads to basically Kashmiri Shaivism, also is not simply a rejection of the world. It's all very, even Eliade's book on yoga, which is great in many ways, doesn't emphasize properly the use of yoga, later medieval Hindu yoga. Though he knew a lot about it, but he deals with yoga as a kind of exclusion of the senses in a way, and discipline. And he's right in many ways and some aspects, but there is tantric yoga, which he knew about a great deal, actually. He, in other words, was another mentor to me. I met him and reviewed his first books in English. Actually his books in French, before they were published, and then after that, I met him through the Bollingen Foundation, which supported him in New York. And then he got a job in Chicago and exploded into fame, and hundreds of books got translated, and then he became very controversial in the thing. But
I was really struck tonight, Gerrit, by the enactment of the poetics that I project you to have that was in that chrysanthemum poem. I felt like I'd never read it before tonight when I heard you read it. And it crisscrossed in my mind as we were sitting here trying to think of something, asking you to talk about what does it mean to you to be influenced by somebody. And when I say that, I think of the polarity or the seeming polarity between Duncan and Olson being two such different poets, different poetics between the two of them, Jungian, Freudian, and yet both those poles are well within your universe and you found to be of influence. So if you could talk about that? What does it mean to Gerrit Lansing to be influenced?
Well, as you know, as well as I, Duncan and Olson admired each other enormously. I think that more than any other poet in America, Olson thought of Duncan as a great poet. I mean, vice versa, Duncan thought of Olson as the greatest poet in the East. So in spite of their differences, and when Olson published the piece against wisdom as such, Duncan was very upset by that and wrote a number of things sort of apologizing and changing his ways about that. Influence is something that happens and that you don't, at least for me, you don't realize at the time. That is, I mean, when I lived in New York, it was the first time I lived in a city. I'd lived in a farm, in a house that was a close family, and at college was an isolated college environment, as it is for most people still. But in New York, Latouche showed me the poetry of the streets too, and beyond that, I was living two or three different lives of people who didn't know each other but friends. I mean, my sexual explorations in New York was quite separate from the friends that I had, like older friends like Latouche or people I knew through him. Yeah. So influence simply happens. I don't think. I mean, I knew I was influenced at one point in college by Gerard Manley Hopkins, for example. I wrote poems that were derivative of that. I knew I was influenced by Wallace Stevens, especially. I wrote derivative poems there that I haven't published. I wrote a poem influenced by Creeley in New York, and before I really knew Creeley, I'd met Creeley, which was actually published in this magazine in New York, semicolon, but I haven't reprinted it ever. Influences are always there, and sometimes, maybe when you're in high school or college, you recognize them completely, as I did. I was influenced by the stories of Lovecraft, which I read in high school, before he became as famous as he is now, way before.
On the flip side, how aware are you of the influence you have on generations of people beyond you? I can mention thousands of people who come to your house on a daily basis that come to see you almost as a pilgrimage, and you meet them at a very human, very, very, very friendship level.
Yeah, well, again, I'm not, since I've, in general, except for a couple of times, not been involved in teaching academically at all, that kind of influence I haven't wanted to have.
Right.
So the other kind of influence is, you know, sort of unknown to me. It seems it's for a while I was a kind of professional astrologer in New York. I studied with a woman whom Ailey knew, extraordinary woman named Maria Cremeri, who was the astrologer for the Broadway company of what was it called? This big hit with Broadway musical. Also a commercial astrologer. And with some others too. And Zoltan Mason, who is mentioned by other people in the history of New York, who had a bookstore in Lexington Avenue and was a professional astrologer. And actually, accidentally, through a place called the Metaphysical Institute, where I took a course in astrology, I met a man who was a cousin of Lionel Zeprin, where Harry Smith was living. So I met Harry in that way, there, though he also had observed me through other people that I knew. And because, for me, Neptune, which rules Pisces these days, is in a very peculiar place in my chart, a singleton in the 10th house, which means that my influences are kind of octopoid. I mean, they don't, they're not direct in a way, or at least I don't know about them, because Neptune creates confusion a lot, or bewilderment, as Fanny so wonderfully says. Where are you, Fanny? Yeah.
Wanted to mention.
Yeah.
When I first met you, our first conversation, which went on for half, I don't know, maybe 10 hours, one of the things that came up was a shared taste for weird tales and pulp of that sort, and taking it seriously. So I was wondering if you had any recollection of that.
Oh, sure, because at that time I actually met Dorothy McIlrath, who was the editor of Weird Tales magazine, was still going. It closed finally in about, I think, 1953 or 4, but that was the chief publication of Lovecraft. And in Ohio, in high school, there was a newsstand in a town, Chagrin Falls, that carried, it was a pulp magazine. So I read Weird Tales, and I've always been interested in supernatural fiction. And the great British writer H.P. Lovecraft wrote a wonderful book on basically a nonfiction book, a short one, on the history of supernatural fiction, where it's really worth reading even now with the book. He deals with M.R. James, Algernon Blackwood, two great English writers of supernatural fiction. And so that's been an interest of mine forever, yeah.
You know, two or three more questions.
Okay, I just wanted to say tangentially related to that quickly. I remember once that I came to visit you and you said, oh, your aura looks really good, Ruth. And then I came the next time and you didn't say anything about my aura. And so after a few hours, I said, so what's up with my aura? And you said, well, you know, it's pretty good today, but I can't concentrate on it right now. You can't just, you know, we're talking about other things. And I wonder, it's maybe... I don't know if you want to talk about auras, but I'd love to hear what you have to.
Studying on, everyone has an electromagnetic aura. I mean, this is simply a matter of biology or physics. I mean, I could give you, you know, scientific things about that extends in a field beyond not only the head but the entire body. I do not claim to be a diagnostician through the aura at all, not. But in the training of a particular school, a man named Franz Bardon, whose book is called Initiation, who was a German teacher, Initiation to the Hermetics, a very important practical book, part of the training, and it's not only with him, is ways of seeing aura. There are aura goggles that are sold by stores, occult stores, they used to be, and so forth, but anybody can be trained to perceive at least some type of aura. Yeah.
I want to ask.
Oh, wait. I just, I wanted to jump off of the word enactment and now aura. That you are, when I hear you read, your reading comes from not only the work of the mind that you've done, but I happen to know the study of body that you have studied, yoga and other. And so while you've been reading and choosing to read from Cleveland to New York to Annapolis to Gloucester, I'm realizing I have a question now of, now that you're my friend, I imagine you in these different places and wonder if you have a practice for how you write a poem. Has it changed over the years? Do you do it for 3 hours a day or 12 hours a day? Or how has that grown in your life, the practice of writing poetry?
The practice varies with every poem. So it's really hard to say. I mean, some of them as I write early in the morning. The poem that begins the series of editions of my book, The Heaven and Tree Grows Downward, is one of the poems which I literally heard, which I didn't write, early one morning. I heard a voice speaking it. That's unusual. Other poems, the long serial poem is a serial poem in the sense that Blazer talks about that, and Spicer, in the sense that I didn't know exactly what was coming. However, it turns out that it is structured around 18, the number 18, which is the moon, But none of this was in my mind when I wrote it. And so I end with 18. I began to realize what was going on. But that was not the preliminary structure of the poem. I don't write from structures ahead of time, as it were. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I want to know about George Barca. Was he ever an influence?
Well, yes. Calamity Terror, the long poem of George Barca, was very definitely an influence, which I read in college. It was around at that time. And then talking to Robert Duncan, it was a big influence on him, too. And then I read The True Confession of George Barca, a short poem. That was an influence. It's very much like Villon. But not an influence the True Confession, on my own practice of writing, especially, or being like him. Calamity Terror, maybe a little bit more so, because I don't know even, but I certainly found it wonderful. Yes.
I had a question. What's your favorite kinds of poetry to write?
What kind of poetry?
A favorite kind.
Well, I don't know how many kinds there are even to choose from. That's hard to say. I mean, I can think of, classical kinds like a sonnet or it's really hard. The kind of poetry I'd like to write, I've never written. and that is, one of my favorite poems is this one. A fly and a flea and a flew were imprisoned. So what could they do? Said the fly, let us flee. Said the flea, let us fly. So they flew through a flaw in the flue. So nursery rhymes, that isn't a nursery rhyme, but poems like that are my favorite poems. But I've never been able to write a nursery rhyme. Yeah. Or a poem like that poem, which is by Ogden Nash.
Jim, did you have a question?
Yeah. So wrap it up. Where next, what do you see, working on books, or what do you see coming up for you, or where are you going?
I'm working on a poem.
Yeah.
But it's in sort of fragments. There are lines at the time in this particular way. Other poems are, come much more at one time, short poems. This poem is coming in a slightly different way. But maybe the Wizard of Oz and the Blizzard of Oz came, the different sections of it separately too, because that's a relatively long poem for me.
And the poems you've collected in small magazines since that came out, are you going to ever collect them or do anything with them? Or?
Maybe, I hope okay. So. Yeah.
And you're working on the Olson Library now.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's just, this library was given to the Gloucester Writers' Center that was made by an Olson scholar, Ralph Maud, duplicating over 50 years every book that he knew Olson had read. And that was then willed to the Gloucester Writers' Center, which people were all, Amanda and everybody's working on that, gradually getting it to be an available library. We don't really know, at least as Amanda said, in the Writers' Center, what's going to happen.
One more?
Yeah.
Don?
Did you share an interest in Henri Corbin with Olson?
Yes, certainly. And I've also corresponded with Tom Cheatham, who was a Corbin specialist. I did indeed share an interest in Corbin with Olson. Also, Corbin is a very complicated, ambivalent case. Because his relation to Scholem and Eliade, for example, is somewhat dubious. There's still mystery surrounding Corbin for me, anyway, because I have not read all of them. Some of the great books have never been translated from French, on Islam, Iranian.
Just a little follow-up. where Corbin traces the Verrouillian mysticism into contact with Chinese mysticism. Did you follow any of that?
Oh, yes, but not only through Corbin. A lot of my interest in the last years intellectually has shifted to the extraordinary explosion of studies of Taoism and the relation of, Taoist physical practice exercises and to Indian yoga. And a lot of work is still going on there. There's no way of knowing if one preceded the other. My feeling is that it didn't probably true. The Chinese yoga, if you wanted to call it that, it goes way, way back in records now, recently archaeological records earlier. The yoga that's practiced, well, leaving the American yoga aside, in India is always, after medieval, is basically medieval yoga, and it always has a tantric element because that's very important. But it's not necessarily Kashmiri Shaivist yoga. But
Joe, do you want to ask a last question?
Yeah. Gerrit, I just want last question. Wow. Loading. I just wanted to say we've all been sitting here, I'm sure most of us, feeling like I do, sometimes just in awe at the breadth of everything you know and share with us and have for years and years. I guess this isn't even as much a question, but what's always been equally amazing to me, and I know everybody here knows it, and it might not come through in all this discussion, is how much you're part of this world, too, and our children's lives, and we come visit you, and you don't care to beat us with all the books you've read. It's all about what are you doing, tell me about what music you're listening to, what's that new band, so that it's not just about all these people you read and know from all across the studies of the world and our history that we're carrying from both sides of the world, but it's about the here and now. You care about, like, what's the latest pop band? What are our kids reading? What movies are they watching? You're just as interested when I bring my kids up to talk with them about what they're doing. And that's an amazing thing. I don't know if you can comment to that, but I know that brings you great pleasure too. You live the complete life, which is so exemplary for all of us.
Well, I'm curious about most things, I guess. Curiosity is something that, I'm also, curious about things I know nothing about, games that I don't know about and stuff like that. And, so it's as simple as curiosity, I think.
I just mentioned earlier this evening that we're reading Patti Smith's new book.
That I was reading who?
Patti Smith.
Oh, Patti, yeah. That's thanks to Jim. I borrowed M Train.
Yeah.
That's something I'm reading currently. Yeah.
Gerrit came to my class once, and some of the students asked him about some heavy metal bands. And he knew more about these bands than they did. And so some of them made a pilgrimage with me to come up and talk to him because they wanted to pump his brain on heavy metal bands.
Well, I don't know much at all about only a couple that are current 93. And Coil that are not exactly heavy metal, but have other interests, and just by accident.
Do you remember the time we were reading the paper, and I called you and you said, "Do you want to go see Robin Hitchcock with me?" I said, "Sure." And we just drove down and went to see Robin Hitchcock at the at TT's, right? Yeah. But to Joe's point, my mom totally worships Gerrit because he's as happy to see her as any literary figure or anyone else. When my mom comes to town, she's giddy with joy to come see you, and she's met with the same. So thank you. And so are my kids, and so am I. So,
it's all
thank you.
So thanks, everyone.
So
thank
are
you.
We all.
Thanks,
yeah.
everyone.
Yeah.
Thank you all for coming. It's great to see you for a nice
day. Yay! Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.